Catherine Teagan Books and Harper Audio present Cats vs. Robots. This is War by Margaret Stohl and Lewis Peterson. Performed by Johnny Heller. The Known Galaxy. Legend. Planet Binar. Home world of the Binars, Metalheads. HQ of the Galactic Robot Federation. Planet Felinus. Home world of the Cats, Four-Leggers. HQ of the Great Feline Empire. Planet Earth. Home world of humans, Furless Two-Leggers. HQ of nothing in particular. Chapter 1. An Emergency on Earth. The Great Feline Empire, GFE. Ponce de Leon, second in command and Major Meow Domo of the Great Feline Empire, padded toward the entrance to the Grand Throne Room. His belly swung as he moved, sort of like a church bell, only furrier and more silent. The Major was hurrying, and the Major didn't hurry often. Pounce was a dignified-looking fellow, a jellicle cat with a bit of black goatee beneath his whiskers and tuxedo fur markings that culminated in an unusually big white spot on his glossy chest, of which he was most proud, and four white mittened paws, which he despaired of keeping clean. Pounce was an oddity among his peers because he was, well, organized, an attribute no self-respecting cat would aspire to. Pounce embraced his quirk, however, and put it to good use in serving the Feline Empire and its ruler, the venerable and rather ancient Chairman Meow. Pounce was no spring kitten himself. As a well-mannered eighth-lifer, per GFE slang, Pounce generally liked to keep his mind on the finer things. A fancy vest with a matching bow tie, a high shelf to nap on, a sunny patch of carpet, a gently dripping faucet. Not today. Today, as Pounce raced through the palace halls, he could think only of one thing. His job. A topic to be avoided in pleasant conversation, since work was the very topic cats despised above all others. Pounce, to the shock of his friends, actually enjoyed it. And a good thing he did, because Pounce's job was to protect the Feline Empire from threats far and wide, real and imagined. The GFE had many enemies, but none more feared than the Robot Federation, the Binars. For as long as any cat could remember, which wasn't that long, the GFE had been at war with the robots. Nobody remembered how the war began or even why. In fact, nobody even questioned whether the war was a good idea. Everybody simply accepted that cats and robots just didn't get along. After all, Binars were a culture obsessed with order and rules. If this, then that was their motto, which, in robot speak, means that every action must have a predictable, logical consequence. Robots believed every question must have an answer, one or zero, true or false, good or bad, on or off. In certainty, we find security, was another Binar motto. Binars liked mottos. The GFE, in contrast, couldn't even be bothered to come up with a motto. If they did, it might be a hasty sketch of a cat snoozing in a patch of sunlight. The Feline Empire was not concerned with rules or consistency. For cats, questions had infinite answers, from yes to no and everything in between, including a shrug and a yawn. Make no mistake, cats did have rules, and they agreed rules were generally meant to be followed, but only if you felt like it. Because cats and robots were close neighbors in the galactic community, they were constantly fighting. Cats often found themselves wandering into robot territory quite unintentionally, creating equally accidental havoc for the robots along the way. On the other hand, the robots, quite intentionally, were constantly trying and failing to invade and bring order to feline society. The very idea of such a disorganized neighbor as the Feline Empire made the robots overheat with frustration. Pounce shuddered when he thought about the robot's ultimate goal: to tame the cats. He paused and coughed up a tiny hairball at the notion. The Major composed himself and, his swaying belly in tow, loped inside the Grand Throne Room. He slowed as he approached the massive upholstered Grand Throne and started scratching it, as one does when one is a cat trying to get the attention of the chairman of the great feline empire. The chairman's chair, the Meow's Grand Throne, was rumored to be the most expensive and elaborate cat tower ever created. Or rather, towers, 7 to be exact, each 4 stories high, with 7 separate satin-padded and shag-carpeted curl-up cubbies connected by ramps, silken rope bridges, and slides. In other words, it was a throne worthy of the claws of the prime leader of the GFE, the ruddy Abyssinian short hair known as Chairman Meow. The chairman had a sunburnt-looking orange splash across his nose and a fine dark M marking between his eyes and forehead, like most tabbies. But the finer hairs of his ears and whiskers had already turned white, and now even his undercoat was going snowy. The chairman was well into his 9th life. As he anxiously scratched at the base of the throne, Pounce arched his back with gusto, an important expression of respect for a naturally gustoless breed, and dug in. The chairman opened one eye and peered over the edge of the top platform, easily a 12-tail length above where the Major waited. "No," Chairman Meow blinked. "It's the dull, stuffy one."
"Your Orangeness," Pounce nodded. "I have important news."
"Important?" The enormous cat rolled slowly forward on his fluffy bed, yawning.
"I seriously doubt it. Not unless you're here to tell me the accursed binars have self-destructed, or the canoes escaped that doghouse of a prison planet.
And the humans," he sighed.
"Well, I can't even imagine a world where those furless creatures are important."
"Try," the Major said, clawing a telegram from the pocket of his hand-stitched vest. "Because the furless are why I'm here. It seems they've made an important discovery. We've received an urgent message from one of our agents on the furless planet, along the borders of robot territory. Remember? Earth?"
"Not really."
The chairman yawned as he thrust his massive, rippling stomach up and out, offering it up to the ceiling. "Well," Pounce continued patiently, "it appears one of the furless has created something quite dangerous, something that could give the robots a decided advantage in the war." Meow groaned.
"Danger is boring. War is boring. Let's talk about something else."
The Major grew frustrated. "Sir, this invention could provide robots with an infinite source of power. They would never have to recharge. If they got their graspers on this, they might even have the energy to reach the very heart of the feline empire."
"Still bored," Meow purred.
Pounce saw he would need to take a different approach to get Meow's attention.
"This invention could also be a great benefit to you, Chairman."
Meow stopped licking himself long enough to look at Pounce.
"Me? Okay, I'm not bored."
Pounce used his most dramatic voice.
"Rightly so, sir, because this very same furless invention could be used to give cats more than 9 lives."
"Wait, huh?"
Now Meow tried to sit up, struggling to support himself with the paw at either side.
"What are we talking here?
10? 12?
His belly billowed out toward his splayed feet like a watermelon suddenly trying to fold itself in half. Pounce shook his head.
"Numberless, according to my sources."
Meow stared.
"So, like, 14?
Cats were not great with numbers greater than 9.
"Like forever, sir, which is close to, if not more than 20.
Pounce shoved the message back into his vest. The chairman hauled himself up onto all 4 paws and was now howling over the length of his grand throne room.
"By my gray whiskers, we must have this invention. Send the fleet. Dispatch my..."
He looked down at Pounce.
"You."
Pounce looked up at Meow and saluted, a quick flick of his white-tipped tail.
"Unfortunately, the fleet has gone missing again, but I am prepared to investigate immediately."
The chairman continued bellowing,
"Find the furless thingy find it and steal it for the glory of the great feline empire and for the glory of its great feline chairman.
As you wish, Pounce muttered, knowing the chairman wasn't listening, and with that he hurried out the door of the throne room. He returned to his office, directly to his waiting royal assistant to the GFE, a caramel-striped scamp otherwise known as Oscar the Wild, who was busily chewing his favorite random shred of plastic. Oscar scratched behind one ear.
Did you get the mission or whatever approved? The thing, the furless thing that was so urgent,
He tried to remember, but truthfully, the intern's head had a much easier time accepting scratching than thinking. The major sighed.
Yes, Oscar, we're off to Earth for the glory of the Empire. And the glory of, well, just a whole lot of glory all around. Now come, we've got a lot to do to get our ship organized. Pack up my spare vests and bow ties and as many treats as you can carry.
But then Pounce stopped talking because Oscar had wandered away to play soccer with his beloved plastic shred.
Meow.
Chapter 2. Bad News from the Humans. The Robot Federation. Across the galaxy, on the robot planet Binar, a similar scene was playing out. Robot BP-4707, known as Sir Beepsalot, loyal second in command to the supreme leader of the Robot Federation, wobbled anxiously back and forth on his one wheel, just outside the Royal Robot Throne Room. His primary screen, which had the appearance of a single eye, was blinking rapidly. Beeps had big news, and it was his job, among many others, to deliver it to his boss, or rather, the boss. Robot AA-001, known as Supreme Leader of All, yes, all, robots. Codename Slayer. Beeps had just received a shocking message from a primitive, distant planet about an incredible new technology. Some human, of all creatures, from Earth, of all places, had invented a chip that seemed too good or bad to be true. On the one grasper, the chip could, if it really existed, solve one of the robot's biggest problems, battery life. No more recharging, no more limits to how far they could go. Imagine the possibilities. On the other grasper, this chip could also be used by air breathers, including four-legged flea bags, to extend their lifespan indefinitely, which to Beep's thinking was a big, big problem. If this chip fell into the wrong paws, it could potentially upset the balance of power between the Robot Federation and their most hated, annoying, and unconquerable enemy, the Feline Empire. Advantage cats. R.I.P. robots. From the first time the robots encountered the cats centuries ago, they had been nothing but trouble. Cats represented everything the robots despised. They had no respect for authority. They didn't obey orders. They left fur, or worse, wherever they went. They thought the entire universe was a toy for them to play with. They didn't even have a decent motto. It was as if the great maker had created the perfect creature to annoy the robots. Robots had survived the cats thus far due to their one critical weakness, a short attention span. They were constantly losing their fleet, chasing tails of passing comets. If this chip gave them longer lives, that could only lead to longer attention spans, which could only result in trouble for the Robot Federation. This was not the kind of news Slayer liked to hear. Beeps loved his job, but even he had to admit that his boss could be rather difficult, especially when it came to receiving unpleasant news. Sir Beepsalot rolled quietly to the open door and slowly extended a probe for a quick scan of the room. In the center of the room, atop a throne built using the most precious and reflective of metals, the ruling robot sat transfixed, holding an elaborate, large, shiny mirror. Slayer was admiring a new holographic cat's skull and crossbones decal on the side of his ample frame. Slayer loved decals, although he insisted on calling them tattoos. Obviously, tattoos are much cooler than stickers, and Slayer was all about being cool. He spun around on his three-wheeled black treads, the lights in the room flashing on his perfectly polished titanium plating. A sleek communication screen, which was also his face, swiveled to look at the mirror, and a wicked grin flashed brightly as he admired his perfect coolness. Beeps rolled his eye.
He thought such unnecessary adornments were tacky.
Oh, that's beepin' awesome, said the Supreme Leader to himself.
In the reflection of his mirror, Slayer noticed Beeps's probe and spun around, excited.
Beeps, is that you, number two? Come in, I want you to see my new tat.
Resigned, Beeps retracted his probe and rolled slowly around the corner into a vast hall, flooded with bright lights, every surface covered in shiny, reflective chrome. It was dizzying. If Beeps had a stomach, it would certainly be churning. As it was, his circuitry was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.